quite open feel about it. It's much less confrontational. At Songs, I felt was something that was like this thing sitting in the corner that, you know, you approach with care. In a way, it's an exact tribute to capturing the emotions of the time and the chemistry between the people, both those records.
It was a difficult record to make, really difficult in the end. And I think it was a real sense of relief when it was finished.
Everything was changing around that record then, you know, and I mean, to the extent I changed, you know, I moved on as well, you know, partway through that record. So, yeah, there was a lot of volatility, shall we say, you know, it's just, it didn't affect the result. These were internal things that were going on, and it didn't, you know, it doesn't affect the audience. The audience really are not privy to that stuff. So the demand for the band was still massive. I mean, this was the follow-up record and tour to what had been a massive, you know, international record before that. So, you know, from the audience point of view, it was all hunky-dory.
Bruce Kirkland actually got hold of me, and I was living in Earl's Court in London in this flat, and like I said, I was a mess. And by that time, pretty much unable to even leave my flat. But I remember, for some reason, I picked up the phone, and it wasn't something I often did. And it rang, and there was Bruce, and he said, "Yeah, it's Bruce. You're number one in USA. Yeah, you know, and you're number one in the UK." And it was like simultaneously in the same, which was apparently some kind of feat.
I was amazed. I was away on holiday at the time. I remember getting a fax, you know, saying that the album had gone number one in 17 countries.
They're at the top of the heap, and you know, they've won. They're number one on the mainstream chart.
Yes, I think America was shocking how big it became, and certainly that was a pinnacle point, which helped to even increase things further, and that was a highlight. But yes, it was interesting how big it was and how ferocious the fans were.
It was very pleasing because we felt in Germany is a big part of the development of Depeche, of the building process of Depeche, and the reflection to other countries abroad, you know.
More than double platinum, more than 700,000 albums. It was really a major, with lots of success for her. And doing an album after so big success is always very, very difficult.
By then, we were at the point of, this is a big band and you've got to play it and you can't not play it. And we were okay. We were over the hump, if you like. Violator had taken us over that hump to where people were starting to say, you know, yeah, we have to play these records.
As the organiser of the Q Awards, it was then we thought, shit, we've got to get them to the Q Awards because this is one of the big UK bands and no one's ever given them an award. It just seemed wrong.
That was incredibly satisfying, yeah. And a big relief, I suppose. Everybody took... I wouldn't say it took pressure off people, but it was definitely, you know, relief of tension at that point.
We did know that we were going out on a huge tour after that. And of course, you know, that's always, you know, a little bit scary.
first for me. I'd never designed a stage before, and I had no idea about cost, and I didn't realize how much work it was, because all those screens, and you had to make films and then work out the delay and everything.
You can see here there's two levels. There was a main level on the say ground floor, as it were, which was Dave's stage, main stage for Dave, where he could run around. Then you have the top stage, where the synthesizers would be, so Martin, Alan and Fletch would be on the top stage. I would then have video screens put in between the two stages.
I was very excited when I saw the production for the first time and all the film screens. When we put the tapes together for the show and we rehearsed and it all sounded great, and I thought, yeah, this is going to be fantastic. And then when audiences turn up and see that and it all works, that's a great buzz, and much more than going to number one.
As long as the album continues to sell and the singles continue to chart and radio continues to play, you can continue to tour, and in fact you should continue to tour. Yeah! Touring is probably the one thing that most UK acts don't do. Depeche Mode always did do.
The bigger the production, the longer you've got to stay on the road in order to pay for it, basically. You know, it costs so much to keep it out on the road. It doesn't make sense to build such an enormous production and then play 5 dates with it.
We spent about 9 months making it, and then 3 or 4 weeks off, and then we're in rehearsals, you know.
The tour was more than 150 shows.
It was immense, you know.
I wasn't surprised by the length of it. I think the problem with the Depeche Mode tour was that it really spotlighted everything that was kind of going wrong internally. You know, whatever conflicts existed within the band were amplified by night after night, you know, the grueling nature of being on the road.
Nearly killed us all, you know, physically, for sure.
Especially back then, it was like, you know, endless parties and, you know, it was just out of control. Oh yeah! When I come up, when I rush.
You know, to always have a you know, smiling face and be positive when you're taxed, you're up late, you're touring, you're doing after show meet and greets, you're doing early morning press, you're doing TV interviews during the day. It's tough. It's a tough life for a band.
Martin had a couple of hospital visits himself, and Fletch was really a mess too.
Dave was just loving it. He was just on a different planet.
On that whole tour, you know, I was still depressed, clinically depressed. It was very difficult for me.
Fletch didn't finish the tour, as I recall. And Martin had a very difficult time in the middle of that tour. Toward the